the worst enemies. That's why my KGB instructors specifically made the point, never bother with leftists. Forget about these political prostitutes. Aim higher. This was my instruction. Try to get into large circulation, established conservative media. Reach, filthy rich movie makers, intellectuals, so-called academic circles. Cynical, egocentric people who can look into your eyes with angelic expression and tell you a lie. These are the most recruitable people, people who lack moral principles, who are either too greedy or too suffer from self-importance. They feel that they matter a lot. These are the people who KGB wanted very much to recruit.
But to eliminate the others, to execute the others, don't they serve some purpose? Wouldn't they be the ones they rely on?
They serve purpose only at the stage of destabilization of a nation. For example, your leftists in the United States, all these professors and all these beautiful civil rights defenders, they are instrumental in the process of the subversion only to destabilize the nation. When their job is completed, they are not needed anymore. They know too much. Some of them, when they get disillusioned, when they see that Marxist-Lenin has come to power, obviously they get offended. They think that they will come to power. That will never happen, of course. They will be lined up against the wall and shot. But they may turn into the most bitter enemies of Marxist-Leninists when they come to power. And that's what happened in Nicaragua. You remember most of these former Marxist-Leninists were either put to prison or one of them split, and now he's working against Sandinistas. It happened in Grenada when Maurice Bishop was already a Marxist. He was executed by a new Marxist who was more Marxist than this Marxist. Same happened in Afghanistan when first there was Taraki, he was killed by Amin, then Amin was killed by Babrak Karmal with the help of KGB. Same happened in Bangladesh when Mujibur Rahman, very pro-Soviet leftist, was assassinated by his own Marxist-Leninist military comrades. It's the same pattern everywhere. The moment they serve their purpose, all the useful idiots are either be executed entirely, all the idealistically minded Marxists, or exiled or put in prisons, like in Cuba. Many former Marxists are in Cuba, in prison. So most of the Indians who were cooperating with the Soviets, especially with our Department of Information of the USSR Embassy, were listed for execution. And when I discovered that fact, of course I was sick. I was mentally and physically sick. I thought that I'm going to explode one day during the briefing at the ambassador's office. I would stand up and say something that we are basically a bunch of murderers. That's what we are. It has nothing to do with friendship and understanding between the nation and blah, blah, blah. We are murderers. We behave as a bunch of thugs in a country which is hospitable to us, a country which with ancient traditions. But I did not defect. I tried to get the message across. To my horror, nobody wanted even to listen, least of all to believe what I had to say. And I tried all kind of tricks. I would leak information through letters or lost documents or something like that. And still I got no message. The message was not published even in the conservative mass media of India. The immediate impulse to defect was Bangladesh crisis, which was described by American correspondents as Islamic grassroots revolution, which is absolute baloney. There was nothing to do with Islam, and there was no grassroots revolution. Actually, there are no grassroots revolutions, period. Any revolution is a byproduct of a highly organized group of conscientious and professional organizers, but has nothing to do with grassroots. In Bangladesh, it was nothing with grassroots. Most of the Awami League party members, Awami League means People's Party, were trained in Moscow in the high party school. Most of the Mukti Fauj leaders, Mukti Fauj in Bengali means People's Army, same as SWAPO and all kind of liberation armies all over the world, the same bunch of useful idiots. They were trained at Lumumba University and various centers of the KGB in Simferopol, in Crimea, and in Tashkent. So when I saw that Indian territory is being used as a jumping board to destroy East Pakistan, I saw myself, thousands of so-called students, traveling through India to East Pakistan, through the territory of India, And Indian government pretended not to see what's going on. They knew perfectly well, the Indian police knew it, the intelligence department of Indian government knew it, the KGB of course knew it, and the CIA knew it. That was most infuriating, because when I defected and I explained to the CIA debriefers they should watch out because East Pakistan is going to erupt any moment, they said I was reading too many James Bond novels. Anyway, so East Pakistan was doomed. One of my colleagues in the Soviet consulate in Calcutta, when he was dead drunk, he ventured into the basement to relieve himself, and he found that big boxes which said printed matter to Dhaka University. Dhaka is the capital of East Pakistan. And since he was drunk and curious, he opened one of the boxes and he discovered not printed matter, he discovered Kalashnikov guns and ammunition in there. Anyway, it's a long story. When I saw the preparations for the invasion into East Pakistan, obviously I wanted to defect immediately. The only thing I couldn't at that time make up my mind when and where and how. One of the reasons, of course, you see, I was in love with India. I mentioned it before. I spoke the languages. I socialized with people. And I understood that I had to act fast unless I want this beautiful country to be permanently and irreparably damaged by our presence,